my life is hectic, but the only thing that I can seem to think about is you. People always asking, what would Jesus do? I guess that everybody else is thinking about you too. All around the world, what they talk about is you.
Welcome to the Nicole Mason Show. I am certainly honored that you have tuned in again this week. And I encourage you to set your appointment with me every Tuesday from 4 to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And the Nicole Mason Show showcases phenomenal women who are using their talents, skills, and gifts to move the world. And so today, the phenomenal woman that I want to feature is me, myself, and I. So I wanted to take this time to share a little bit about me. Since we started the show, we have showcased other powerful women. And so I thought that I would share a little bit about who I am so that you'll know who Nicole Mason is. So one of the things I wanted to talk about as it relates to myself is just my journey to where I am today. So I am a native Washingtonian, love Washington, D.C., love Washington, D.C. And I wanted to be an attorney since I was the age of 9. I loved Perry Mason, yes, particularly at the end when Perry Mason would have the witness on the stand and just the series of questions that he would pose would cause the person to confess. So I was always intrigued by Perry Mason. I loved to speak up for others who either wouldn't or couldn't speak up for themselves. I've always been an advocate for what I felt was right, an advocate for justice. And so that's what I wanted to do. Never wanted to do anything else other than be an attorney. And so today I am just that. I'm an attorney in the state of Maryland, and I love the practice of law. I also love to write, so I'm a writer. I'm a published author, and you can check my book out at mondaymorningmotivations.net. That's all one word, mondaymorningmotivations.net. And writing for me has always been very therapeutic, and so what I do is I share my writings with others. And so I love to write. And I also love to speak. I am a preacher by vocation, love the Word of God, and I love to use the Word of God to empower others. Which brings me to our subject matter today, surviving the holiday season after the loss of a loved one. And I have to share with you that this is not just something that I've studied to share with you, but this is something that I have walked out myself. And, you know, grief is very hard, it's very difficult, but it's something that's universal because we all experience the loss of a loved one at some point in time in our lives. And for me, that time came 9 years ago this year in the month of November, November the 2nd, my mom went to sleep and she just did not wake up. She had a heart attack in her sleep. And that was the beginning of the most devastating time in my life. I was an only child. And for those of you who are only children, yes, I am very, very special. And people always say, oh, you're spoiled. No, I like to call it loved. Just really, really loved. So my mom passed away November the 2nd. She went to sleep and just didn't wake up, as I stated. And I was 8 months pregnant at the time with my third son. And 17 days later, my grandmother passed away. And so needless to say, that was a very devastating time for me. It was devastating. It was difficult. And I really didn't know what to do other than just not do anything at that time. And during the course of my process of processing the grief, I read a lot of different materials. And one of the things that is very, very critically important, and I want to share this with you today, if indeed you are in the midst of grieving, that is not the time to make emotional decisions. That is not the time to make critical changes in your life, because the emotion that's attached to grief can make us do some things that when we come out of it, it's probably not what we wanted to do. So in one particular book that I read, there was a chart that they listed, and they talked about all these different life-altering events happening at one time. And I found myself in that state, losing a loved one, the birth of a child, transitioning in employment. All of those things constitute life-altering decisions. And the one thing that you want to be certain of is that you need to be clear in your thoughts when you're making life-altering decisions. And so for me, during that time, the thing that kept me grounded was my faith. Now, everybody may not have a faith or have something outside of yourself that you believe in. But I want to encourage you to make that decision today, because it's your faith that will keep you, that will sustain you. And one of the things that's important, you need to have your roots deep when things are going well, because life will hit every one of us, and you need to be grounded in something. And that something for me was and is the Word of God. You need to have something that grounds you and sustains you and that keeps you focused, so that when you're going through that kind of situation, you don't go to the left nor the right, and you don't go back to the familiar. It's too easy to go back to what's familiar when we're going through hard times. And this is why it's critically important to have a faith in something that is bigger than you. Okay? And so with that time period in my life, my mom died first, like I stated. Then my grandmother died 17 days later. I was 8 months pregnant with my third son. And, you know, to be perfectly honest with you, I just, when I look back on it sometimes, I'm thinking, wow, that was a lot. And I know that some of you are sitting there and you have the same kind of thought process about what you may be dealing with yourself. But I'm here to tell you that you can make it. I'm here to tell you that there is something that you have to do with every situation that happens in your life. And what I mean by that is, what you go through, it doesn't come to kill you. Because the God that we serve does not come to break us, but he comes to build us up and to make us better. And for me, having gone through that situation, I've been able to help countless others who have lost their mothers, who have lost their grandmothers, and who've lost loved ones in their lives, to be able to let them know that they will come through. And that is my message for you today, that you will come through, that you will make it. And during the holiday season, it is a very difficult time. And I wanted to share with you today, as a source of encouragement, that this too shall pass. That was one of my mother's favorite sayings to me when I would go to her just in a frenzy about something that was happening in my life at the time. And she would be so cool and so calm and so collected. And she would say, "This too shall pass." And you know what? It did. And the thing about grief, this is what I've come to know in the 9 years that I have been walking this walk, and I want to share this with you today, is, you know, you turn the corner in grief. And this is how I explain it, or how I have interpreted it in my own life. I don't think it's something that you ever come out of, but you turn the corner and you get better. Because the reality is, you can never replace your loved one. The void that person leaves, particularly depending upon the kind of relationship you had with that person, the depth of the love that you shared with that person, it is a void that can never be filled. But I am here to tell you that it will get better. You will go from sorrow into using the memories that you shared with that person as a source of encouragement, as a source of love, as a source of being able to pull on in those difficult moments or those difficult times, such as the holiday season. And so for me, I've been able to think about how my mother poured her very life into me, how my grandmother poured her very life into me. And through that love, because love never dies. Love never dies. And so as long as I am living and breathing, so are my mom and my grandmother. And so it is with you today, that your loved one, their spirit lives on in you and around you. The memories live on. And most importantly, the love that you shared never dies. And so one of the things that I have found to be very, very helpful to me, of course, like I said, is my faith and going to a worship service. And so for some of you, it may be the temple, it may be the synagogue. Wherever you find solace, I encourage you to make it a ritual, make it a practice, because your tank, if you will run empty, and you need to fill it up. And the way that you fill it up is whatever your practice is. For some people, the practice is prayer. For others, the practice is meditation. Whatever your practice is, it's important for you to exercise that practice. The other thing that you will have to do in the face of grief, in the face of losing a loved one, you have to create new rituals, because the old rituals, they will sometimes keep you in a not so feeling good state. I don't want to call it depression, but if you're not careful, those times when you're having a really hard time, it's very easy to fall into depression. Now, I'm one of those people, I believe in counseling, and grief counseling is also very, very important if you feel like you just can't move forward. Counseling plus Jesus equals success. Now that's me. That may not be you, but that's me. Counseling plus whatever your practice is equals success. There isn't any shame in going to seek help, because grief is very hard and it can be very difficult. It is an energy that you need to move, because if it stays stagnant in your spirit and in your soul, it will literally kill you from the inside out. The pain and the sorrow that comes along with it, if you are not careful, it will kill you from the inside out. And this is why I wanted to have this conversation with you today while we're in this season, because I know what it feels like to long for your loved one and they are not there. I know what it feels like to be in such a devastating state because it was unexpected. You didn't see it coming. You went to bed one night and everything was fine, and you woke up the next day and things have changed dramatically. I know what that feels like. But I am here today to tell you that this too shall pass, meaning the grief that you feel, the heaviness that you feel, it will pass. There was a saying that my grandmother would say when I was coming up, that time heals all wounds. And I have come to know that that is true, that it will take time to heal you. It will take time to heal your heart. And for me, during that time, the way that I described it, it felt like my heart had been blown into a million pieces, and I just couldn't find the pieces to put them back together. But I'm here to tell you that God will put those pieces back together for you. Not only is it your practice that you need to engage in, whether it's your faith, prayer, meditation, but you also need a good support system. You need people who can come and sit with you and have what is known as the ministry of presence. And I tell you that I had so many people who thought it not robbery to come and just sit with me, not saying anything. My prayer partner in particular, Reverend Rochelle Durant Esquire, she would just come and sit with me weeks, and not say anything if I didn't want to talk if I wanted to talk. And we all have that someone in our lives. And so reach out to that person in your life and let them know that you need help. So that's the beginning of our conversation together today. And I want to open up the lines just to hear from you. If this is you and you want to connect, and just so that I can let you know that I will be praying for you, let me give you the number to call today. It's 240-343-4742. Again, the number is 240-343-4742. 4742. So just call and connect. When we come back from this break, I'll talk a little bit more about some of the steps that you can take to survive this holiday season after losing your loved one. And I'll also give you a couple of resources that helped me tremendously. So stay tuned.
I need a healing for my soul, so give me a healing for my soul. I need a healing for my soul, so give me a healing for my soul.
Lord, I'm looking for a new life, just for my soul.
Just for my soul, I need.
And I'm tired of crying all night, just for my soul.
Just for
take away this pain and misery, 'cause God, I just can't do this by myself. I need a help, Lord.
I need a healing for my soul.
Gave my body and my soul away. So now I come to you just to be whole. Heal my soul, Lord.
I need a healing for my soul.
Come on and heal
give
me.
Healing for my soul.
Would you please see about
need
me,
a
Lord?
For my soul.
Absolutely. And you can certainly get your healing by trusting and believing God. So I wanted to also just talk a little bit about some of the things that helped me during my journey of grief. In addition to time, because I'm an avid reader, I read anything that talked about the death and dying process. I wanted to read about it. I wanted to know everything that I could about it. And so one of the authors that I really and thoroughly enjoyed was Elizabeth Kubler-Ross. And she is a premier expert, if you will, on the death and dying process. I wanted to read about that. I also liked Neil Anderson's Conversations with God. That was very instrumental for me. And I read Mitch Albom, and he had several books about just heaven and death and angels. And so anything that intrigued me or anything that I could get my hands on that talked about the process of dying and how to cope after you lose a loved one. And so I want to encourage you, if you are an avid reader, the library is a good place for you to just go and browse and choose the topic of the book. If it resonates with you, when you read the topic or the title of the book, pick the book up and see if it's something in there that will comfort you. Maybe not the whole book, but it just may be one sentence that comforts you at that particular moment when you get it home to read it. Just may be a word, because what I've come to know is that God sends a word of comfort in all kinds of ways and in all kinds of mediums to encourage our hearts, because he certainly understands what it feels like when we're going through that. And so those resources are really good. And you always have some counseling centers in your area, in your church, your temple, your synagogue, whatever you may be connected to. They have counseling groups and they have counseling support groups at the hospitals. You may want to check your local hospital to ask about grief counseling support groups. You have to engage the process. And what I mean by that is grief is universal, meaning that it touches all of us. And so you have to engage the process, because sometimes people don't make it through the grieving process. They use all different kinds of vices to try to numb the pain, because that's what you really want to do. You want to numb the pain. But when you engage the process, you have to feel the pain and you have to embrace the pain, because it's there for a reason. You've had a tremendous loss. Now, it would be something totally different if you go through that loss and you feel nothing. It's just like our bodies. We get pain in our bodies to alert us that there is a problem. And we're thankful that we can feel when there is a problem. There are some places, some diseases, you know, leprosy and some other kinds of diseases, that the person cannot feel anything. And so they can harm themselves because they don't have any feeling in their limbs. And so God thought about everything when he created us. And he knew that we would have the kind of pain in our hearts that sometimes would cause us to want to give up, to want to throw in the towel. But that's just the time when we have to turn to him so that we can get the strength that we need to be a source of encouragement for somebody else. And so it is important for you to understand that your pain can turn into a blessing for someone else. The pain is not just to break you down. The pain is to build you up so that you can be a blessing to someone else. And so I want to encourage you to engage the process. Feel the pain. Feel the pain, because you can't make it go away. Even if people try to numb it with all kinds of different vices, when the vice wears off, the pain is still there. So it is incumbent upon you to go through the pain, process it, interpret what's happening to you, and then make it work for your good. For me, I processed the pain in an effort so that I could be better, so that I could help others, so that I can really sit here today, 9 years later, to tell you that you can make it. I know from experience, this is not something that someone told me. Now, I know for a fact that there are some critical days from the time of impact to your present state. And what I mean by time of impact, that is the time when you get the news that your loved one has passed away or something. Excuse me. Or something has happened to them. So if you survive the point of impact, you will be okay. If you survive the point of impact, you will be okay. I'm sorry, something is tickling my throat. If you survive the point of impact, you will be okay. And that was a message that I received. Thank you. See, we have some great team members here. Thank you. If you survive the point of impact, you will be okay. And that was a message that I received one night when I was having a really difficult time processing the hurt and the pain and the grief of losing my mother and my grandmother in the same month. My mom passed on November the 2nd, and my grandmother passed November the 19th. And I was just totally devastated. Then I had this little baby that I was to care for. And that was the first time that I had to care for my baby alone, because my mom and my grandmother had always been there to help me and my husband with the baby. In fact, my mother, she retired from her job to take care of my children while I went to law school. We lived right around the corner from each other. And so this was just a very devastating time for not just me, but for my entire family. And I remember one night I was having a very difficult time, and I could hear in my spirit God telling me that you survived the point of impact, you will be okay. And I know that you all remember the point of impact for yourselves when you got the call, or when you received the news, or when someone like myself, someone knocked on your door to tell you that your loved one was deceased. And, you know, if you're sitting here, you survived the point of impact. The worst of it is behind you. Now comes the time to just put your life together without that person's presence. And you can do it. And you will make it. I am speaking to your innermost parts, your innermost being, and commanding you to know that you will make it. And, you know, your body goes through all different kinds of turmoil, if you will, going through that process. And so one of the things that you have to be very, very watchful of is taking care of your body, getting the proper rest, exercising, because exercising helps you feel better, eating a good diet. And I know when you're in the throes of grief, you don't always feel like doing any of those things. And I want to encourage you to give yourself the space and the time to grieve. This is very important. You give yourself the space and the time to grieve. And what I mean by this is, you know, people always tell you where you should be. You should have gotten over it by now. You should be done with that. Are you still crying about that? I had a woman tell me a year after my mom had passed, I was talking to her about something that I was feeling, and she said, oh, you're still talking about that? You know, and so you have to be, you know, very mindful of people and their insensitivity. Sometimes they don't mean any malice, but that's just where they are. That wasn't their loved one. And so you have to learn how to give people a pass, because you don't want to expend your energy on fighting a battle that has nothing to do with you because someone else is being insensitive to your situation. And so give yourself the time and the space to grieve. That means you don't let anybody tell you how far along you should be. Now, let me just put a pin here. If indeed that person is close to you and they sense that perhaps maybe you may be falling into a depression, that's something different. But I'm talking about the people that have not walked very closely with you, who are an outsider, who are outsiders telling you how far you should be. Those are the people that I'm talking about. So disregard them and go through your process. Give yourself the time and the space to grieve. Also, do not compare yourself to anybody else when you're going through this process, where you make yourself feel like you should be further along, or you should be feeling differently by this point or that point. But give yourself the time and the space, because the reality is, in the midnight hour, there isn't anyone there with you. It's just you and your thoughts, you and your emotions, you and your feelings, and you have to learn how to deal with all of that while you're going through this grieving process. And you have to have people around you that you can call. If they just have to be able to stay on the phone sometimes and just listen to you cry. Those are the people that you need in your space when you're going through a difficult time, particularly during this season. One of the things that I said to you earlier was really creating new traditions for yourself, new traditions for your family. And that's very, very important because you can no longer have the tradition the way that it once was. I know we can all talk about the way things used to be. We can yearn for those things, but they will never be the way they used to be. And so it is important that you take the energy to create new traditions with your family, to create new traditions with your friends, the people that have been in your space and the people that have been with you throughout your life and throughout this time period. And really, I don't believe that our loved ones would want us to stay stuck. I don't believe that they would want us to yearn for them so much that we aren't able to move forward. Now, certainly, for those who have been in our space and for those who have loved us, for those who have imparted into our lives, who left us with any ounce of love, I don't believe that they would want us to be stuck. And so I want to encourage you during this holiday season to journal. That's also something that you can do. Journaling is very important, because it allows you the opportunity to get your feelings out on paper, because you want to get them out of your heart, onto the paper, out of your heart, onto someone's ear, but you have to get it out of your heart, because you don't want the grief to wrap up around your heart. I felt at times like I was being suffocated from the inside out, and I had to find a way to move that energy, to move those emotions. And so for me, journaling was very, very important. And so I want to encourage you to go and purchase a pretty journal. And they don't cost that much. Purchase a pretty journal, something that you want to look at. For me, my favorite color is red. So I have so many red journals and red this, red that. I love red. It makes me feel good when I look at it. So get a journal that will encourage you to write, a journal that touches your heart when you look at it because of the color. Maybe you like sparkly things. I love things that bling too. So I have some stuff that's blinging. And so get you something that you like and take the time to write down your thoughts and to write down your emotions, because that's a good way to help you during this season. Write down the good things that you remember about your loved one. Write down the good things that the times that you shared with that person, because those become very critical in those dark days. And you can pick that journal up and you can look at it and it can soothe your heart. The other thing that I did during that time, which I found very, very instrumental in helping me, a friend, she had a scrapbooking session, and it was very, very helpful to me because I was able to scrapbook and pull out some old pictures and put some new sayings on them, put some new pictures around them, and that was very, very therapeutic, and that's something that you can do with your family. during this holiday season. You can create a new tradition doing scrapbooking and get you some pictures that speak to your heart, some pictures of flowers and pictures of colors, pictures of the sky, pictures of the water, things that soothe you, things that bring comfort to your heart. And you can put those around the pictures of your loved one and then write what you loved about that person and write how they impacted your life and write what you would want to do or carry on the things that you know that would make them proud of you. And so that's something else that you can do. And I want to end this time with you to talk to the people of faith. One of the things that I found being a woman of faith, there's always this perception that people of faith do not hurt, or people of faith have it all together and they can process death better than anybody else. Well, I am here to tell you that people of faith hurt too. And anyone who's in your space that is telling you that you should be over it, that all you need is to pray about it and that'll make it all right, no, that's not true. And yes, prayer helps, because I am a woman of prayer, love to pray. But there is also a process that no one can escape as it relates to grief. Now, your process may not be my process and mine yours. And sometimes people can short circuit the process and they find themselves 10 and 15 years later down the line having a nervous breakdown. I do not want that to happen to you. So don't allow anybody else to fool you or to dupe you into believing that just because you are a person of faith that you don't need the time nor the space to grieve, and to grieve properly and appropriately. And that means whatever your process is, it's proper and appropriate. So I certainly thank you all for sharing with me today. And I opened the phone lines up and I didn't get any calls. But if you are watching, be sure to send me a message on Facebook at Nicole Sharon Mason, or like us at the Nicole Mason Show. Or you can tweet at Nicole S. Mason. I want to hear from you. I want to hear how you are surviving the holidays after the loss of a loved one. I also want to know if this has been helpful to you, some of the things that I've shared today. I certainly could go into a whole lot of different things, and we may do that at some other point in the show. But I just wanted to give you some highlights on how to survive the holidays, because this is a time where, you know, people getting together with their families. You know, another time that's very difficult for people who have lost their moms, in particular, is Mother's Day. For those who've lost their dad, Father's Day. So those, all of those critical holidays can be very, very difficult and very stressful. But if you engage the process of grief, you can get through it too. You can get through those holidays, and you can get through those times when you feel the loss of your loved one the most by implementing some of these strategies: journaling, scrapbooking, having a practice of faith, whatever that is for you, praying, meditating, having a good support group. All of those things are very important. And if you want to add to the list, please tweet me at Nicole S. Mason, or on Facebook, Nicole Sharon Mason, or like us on the Nicole Mason Show. We want to hear from you. We want to know that our show today has been helpful to you in some kind of way. And if you have some strategies that you would like to add to what we've talked about, we would love to hear those and to share them with our listeners, because we know that this time is very, very critical for those who have lost their loved ones. And so in that, thank you so much for joining us today. And I want to just say a congratulations to the team here at Listen Vision Live for our award. We were awarded the 2014 Internet Radio Station of the Year by Titan Arts Award Foundation. And we are so excited about that. And I am happy to be a member of this award-winning team because, after all, I'm award-winning myself. I'm phenomenal myself, just like all of you ladies who are watching. You are phenomenal as well. And so connect with me so that we can continue this conversation with phenomenal women. And I just thought today that I would introduce phenomenal me to phenomenal you. And at this time, I want to acknowledge my partners and thank them and give them a shout out. If you would like to become one of our partners, please also send me a Facebook request or tweet at Nicole S. Mason. And we would love to showcase your service or your product on this show. And my partners, Rihanna Wilkes of Glam Rock Artistry. She's my personal makeup artist. I love her. The lady who keeps my hair looking good, Tanya Young. To my graphic artist, she is the best, Angela Burnside of Unique Art Design. To my photographer, Anthony Robinson of ABR Studio. And to the lady who provides my jewelry, Linnell Lightfoot of Linnell's Jewelry Box. And so you can find them on Facebook, and I certainly would encourage you to check them out. So thank you all so very much. I am praying for you that you get through this season. And please know that God is no respecter of person. And he has brought me and my family through nine holiday seasons. And this year we are approaching the holiday and we're feeling good. We're feeling joyful because we know that it's been the hand of God that has helped us get through this time. And just as he has done it for us, he can do it for you too. So join us next week on the Nicole Mason Show from 4 to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, because you never know who you're going to meet on the Nicole Mason Show. Thank you. Have a good afternoon.
This is not the time to get distracted. And this is not the time to go off course. This is not the time to lose your focus. Got a word to do for the Lord. And you cannot afford to lose your way.